audience, settle down, please. Now we come to the next part. Suppose you're facing a crisis. How do you fight the fire that has been lit by the act of commission or omission, which has been brought out by the previous speaker? So what do you do? Do you panic or do you approach a medico-legal helpline? This is what I'll be covering and trying to explain in brief. Now, crisis management can lead to two scenarios. One, you're at the edge and ready to topple. You take that extreme step and you give up. Or is it actually the time to ponder on what you can actually do, seek support, look for help, and delve into your support system to build up a support and advice which can guide you through this adverse time. Now, hospital managements are increasingly facing complaints, consumer courts, civil cases, criminal cases against self or the medical setup, which generally regarding the facilities available, the standards of professional competence, and appropriate therapeutic and diagnostic methods. This in broad covers the scenarios which generally crop up. Now, the spectrum of crisis, as an ophthalmologist, the most common scenarios that we face are cluster infections, endof, you're all aware of this. Again, a very common scenario, wrong IOL, incorrect IOL power in the patient, because you are technician dependent, you're dependent on your assistants, you often do not have the time to go into details yourselves, so you end up with this situation. Failure to recognize retinal problems pre-op. Again, an area, a gray area, a lot of people overlook as a cataract surgeon. You tend to overlook these aspects. Anti-VEGFs, again, a topic by itself, which will be covered later on. And often lack of post-op care by self or your colleagues when you have handed over a patient to them, you have had to leave in an emergency, you have operated a patient, handed over a patient to a colleague, and adequate post-op care has not been given, but the liability still rests with you because you have operated that patient. Now, the enormity of the crisis can be judged by the fact that almost 10,000 to 15,000 medico-legal cases are pending in various courts. This is a rise of almost 25% in the last 5 years. Worldwide and in India, gynecologists and obstetricians are on the top of the chart when it comes to the number of cases which are filed against medicos. If it is of any solace, anesthesiologists and ophthalmologists follow. So we are third and fourth on the list. We are not at number one yet. Now, why is it important in India, fighting the crisis, building up your infrastructure to fight this crisis? In the US, almost one in every four doctors has been sued in his lifetime. We have still not reached that stage. However, in India, it's very easy to file a case with a very low litigation fees. And here, even without legal help, you can fight a case if you just with the help of a regular advocate. In the US, the litigation fees cost around $25,000. Also in the US, it is not easy to file a criminal case against a doctor, but as brought out by the previous speaker, in India, it can be done under section IPC 304A. Now, suppose you are facing the crisis. What is the ABCD for dealing with a medico-legal crisis? Awareness of the negligency. You cannot brush away the fact that a negligence has occurred. Building a strong structure, strengthening processes in your clinic or in your support system. Effective communication. One area where we are actually severely lacking, communication within your staff, communication with the patient. Documentation, again, an area where a lot of us fail to look into the broader aspects of it. And an empathetic attitude and soft skills. Again, something which is not grossly lacking, but which we need to build up on in our practices, in our daily practice. Now, awareness, coming to the A of fighting the crisis. Awareness is that errors are bound to occur in any complex human behavior. Any surgical procedure is a complex human behavior where there is an interaction of various individuals. You have support staff, you have nursing staff, you have technicians, you have a company which is supplying you consumables. So you have drugs. So there is bound to be some error or complications in a complex behavior like this. So it is bound to occur. Be prepared for it. Medical error is an accepted entity. Any surgeon who says, I do not have a complication, is a surgeon who is not operating. It's a well-established fact, we all say it. and you should have well-established risk management strategy and protocols at your center. Now, building a strong structure, the allotment of manpower, the concept of the right man at the right place doing the right job for you should be followed strictly. What we tend to do is one person is missing from the operation theater or from your OPD, you assign another person who has been doing another job for say the last 3 months. You assign him on a job on a day to cover. That is what leads to errors. Following the right methods, the right protocols, using the right machine for the right job, and your material is adequate and what is proper for the required surgery. Communication, the C of this ABCD of crisis, the key is the doctor-to-patient relationship. As brought out by the first speaker, this is the area which is stressed in our general population and environment today. There is a general lack of trust between doctors and the patients. So the key is the doctor-patient relationship. What we need to learn is to communicate effectively and clearly with our patients. Communication is what leads to a drop in adverse situations and what leads to correction of a situation which can worsen, but you can improve that situation by effective communication. So the paradigm or the main issue here is you tell it early, tell it all, and tell it yourself. Do not depute somebody else to tell your complication or your error to the patient. Do it yourself, do it as early as possible, and say it all. Do not hide facts. This is where we land up in problems. We disclose part of the problem, we do not do it in first person, and we tell the patient too late, by the time damage has been done. This is where the crisis management can be managed at the first step itself. Documentation, complete history. Everybody, we've been taught from the first days in medical college, documentation, the history part, as we go higher up or deeper into our practice, because of the load on us, documentation and the history taking is what tends to suffer first. You're always in a hurry, you have volumes to look after. Physical examination, including negatives, have to be recorded. A complete history of all diagnostic tests which have been undertaken and the reasons for undertaking those tests have to be recorded. We do the tests, but we fail to record what was in our mind. For me also, if I advise a patient a test, if I try to recall after 10 days, it will be difficult for me to document what I was actually thinking at that time. So the point is, when you document, when you advise a patient, document it at that very point of time. And a record of treatment with medications prescribed is essential, and any change in treatment is also to be recorded with meticulous details and the reasons for the change in the medication. Documentation continued, procedures recommended or performed, again has to be documented. The patient's response to treatment, whether adverse, inadequate, adequate, and the follow-up plan. Because of the above, so any alterations in the treatment plan because of the response have to be recorded. And please make sure, I know it is difficult, whether your handwriting is legible or not, very difficult at this stage of life to correct your handwriting, but at least you can make an effort that it is legible so that you don't land up in problems where you're not able to recognize your own handwriting. Empathy. The human face of medical care decides the patient's attendant's reaction towards a medical mishap. The whole system of medical establishment has to be made courteous and polite. It cannot be overemphasized. Soft skills are the cornerstone of our practice, in our day-to-day practice. And the soft skills have to start with the receptionist or the entrance to any practice. It starts the patient enters, the moment the patient enters your clinic or your practice. So you have to build it up from that stage. It is not just the doctor's soft skill. It is the soft skill at every stage, at every patient, at every level that the patient is in contact with another human being. And special training needs to be imparted to staff from HRD experts. This is an ongoing process. We can keep repeating this at variant intervals. Now, suppose we still have a crisis. We can take heart from the fact that in 2005, Supreme Court gave a landmark judgment stating that the interpretation of medical negligence in India. And they very clearly stated that no doctor can be arrested simply on filing the complaint against him by any patient or relative of the patient. His arrest can only be there if it is required for furthering the investigation or for collecting